looking for after like August was we saw a big jump in both the producer prices and as well as for consumer prices because of energy. So we're looking for a slower rate of growth for both the headline and the core of 0.3% for CPI, 0.3.2% for the PPI. I think overall, as long as it comes in within, a whisper, I guess, of expectations, the Fed should be fairly comfortable with that. But I think right now the new twist, and sometimes I feel a little bit weird just talking about the data, just given everything that's going on across on the other side of the world now. So I think right now it's the Fed is going to be more cautious in what it says. I thought it was interesting what you're just saying about Fed Speaker Bostic, because even over the weekend, when everyone was talking about how now a vice chair was saying that they're basically going to be on hold. One of the more hawkish Fed members from Dallas also said that basically the financial markets are doing the job for them. Not their words exactly, but that's basically what they're implying. So it seems that they are going to be more firmly rooted, I think, on the sidelines, especially given all this violence that's happening over in Israel right now.
Well, I mean, I feel like they had the same kind of plan as Mike Tyson, right? As soon as you get punched in the face, it changes. And if we get a PPI number that's high tomorrow or a CPI number that's high in the next day, this Fed's data dependent, right? So what's the most important data to be watching?
I think for this week, it's definitely going to be on the CPI front for the core measure. And as we know, it's not even as much as simple as just core anymore. They're looking at all the different components, like the goods side and the services side. And if they start seeing an increase there as well, I think they'll be a little bit more alert. But again, they have to be more cautious because this is one time when there is so much conflict, if it's not just in Russia and Ukraine, but now in Israel. And of course, some of the domestic issues right now playing out in the US House, all the strikes that are going on, there's just so many balls in the air that I think they're going to be more cautious in terms of not wanting to rock the boat too much.
So, Jennifer, given kind of what we see out there in inflation, it's moderating. Hopefully, we'll get more confirmation of that this week. What is the BMO call on just the economy? I mean, is this an economy that can land softly, or is a recession still in the cards?
So we have been on the soft landing. I'm using my air quotes here, soft landing side of the equation for some time. And of course, what's happening recently is making us a little bit more not as comfortable, I guess, as we once were. But we're still looking for a mild, I guess, a nice soft-ish landing. Jobs report last week, like that blew everyone away. My first reaction was, "Oh, come on, we're still being beat by these. We're still being a surprise on the upside for these jobs numbers." Just again showing how resilient, and hopefully it's not sounding too boring anymore, but that resilient word is still being used and being used to apply to the to describe the US economy. So I think that is still shaping up to help that soft landing story. Of course, with wages slowing a bit, that's it wasn't that bad actually, and it's actually a good thing that wage growth slowed. It's still enough to support US consumer spending, but not enough. It wasn't going to fan any flames around the Fed.
Hey, we just saw some strikes in Canada now. GM workers striking there because they can't get the same deal as Ford. Of course, we have strikes here in the US that continue to go on. How do you expect that to affect the economy? Whether it results in, I guess, supply issues driving up car prices or wage issues, when they finally get, a 30% raise.
I want to say a little bit of both. Now, with strikes, again, depending on how long they last for, we will see some sort of a bounce back when things resume. But of course, if it stretches on for a long period of time, it's certainly going to hurt the economy. Already, we're starting to see potentially like some suppliers, for example, not just directly within the auto producers themselves, but suppliers to that industry are starting to pull back, or potentially could start pulling back as well, depending again on how long this strike lasts for. So while we could see a downturn, we probably will. And it's going to be, as you pointed out, upward pressures on wages, which is not a good thing. This is also has the potential to throw another curveball into this whole soft landing scenario. At the same time, it's got to be, both sides have to agree, right? So it can't be too outrageous, I don't think. So, but overall, you're seeing more of these strike actions take place, and of course, we saw the one of the was it the writer's strike that ended earlier this weekend, which is good news. But then you see other things playing out. Like I think Walgreens pharmacists, for example, were already striking as well for are walking out on management apparently in several parts of the country. So just a lot of more worker unhappiness, I guess, being shown to management.
Jennifer, what's kind of your view on China? It seems like the reopening has underwhelmed, I guess is probably the fair way to say it. And so there's some concern there across markets, including energy markets, the strength or lack thereof of China's economy. How do you view that?
So the first quarter rebound, you know, which seems way back when, was actually very strong. But of course, that fizzled very quickly. Things went downhill fairly quickly. And now, but it seems to be, and again, I've only seen some of the August data and a little bit of the September data. Things seem to have stabilized a little bit. And the fact that they're cutting rates, they're easing reserve requirements, perhaps introducing some more fiscal stimulus will help stabilize. But I don't think we're going to see a huge rebound in the fourth quarter.